All right. Hello and welcome back to another fun-filled, jam-packed episode of the Hammercast. I'm your host, Alex, the Hebrew Hammer Salkin, and joining me today is none other than Tom Morrison, who is a strength coach. That's right. I don't know if you can see. If you're watching this on YouTube, you'll see the bicep flex that he just gave all of us. I'm sure he will do another couple of these throughout. I encourage him to do another couple of these. He's a strength training coach. He is a flexibility and mobility maestro coming all the way from Northern Ireland. And as it turns out, there's a lot of very interesting things about him. In fact, I've got a couple of fun facts pulled up so that folks who have not heard of him will soon get a better idea of exactly who we are dealing with. For instance, I didn't know this. Scientists believe that the clap that Tom Morrison did in his first video was actually the Big Bang. To me, that makes perfect sense. I had not really considered it. You know, it wasn't something I thought too deeply about, but it does make a lot of sense. Tom doesn't wear pants except for on Thong Thursday. I'm very grateful that we are doing this interview just with, you know, like the chest up, essentially, so that I don't have to see any proof of that. And Tom is perfect. So others have something to strive for. And I definitely feel like I've already leveled up just with these few minutes of chatting before. And he's also a very funny guy. He's got a great sense of humor, which I think is very important because a lot of people take this training and, you know, physical culture thing way too seriously. So we need people who can make others laugh. And Tom will definitely do that. And he'll also drop some knowledge bombs, which is seems to be his specialty. Because, look at this. We've already got some brewing in the mix. Now, before we get started in earnest, I'm going to remind my listeners, that if they have not already, I highly encourage them to get my 9-minute kettlebell and bodyweight challenge, which you can do at 9minutechallenge.com. It shows you how to use not but the power of your gait pattern to get a lot stronger via stuff like crawling, loaded carries, and more. And best of all, it can be applied to any other strength training program that you're doing, as it's designed to be complementary, not competitive with what you're doing. So 9minutechallenge.com, get your own free copy. And there you have it. So, Tom, without further ado, welcome to the show.
Thank you very much for having me, buddy. We definitely should talk about kettlebells on this, I think, because they are a very underrated tool and they get a lot of hate. But for what they are, they're absolutely amazing. So we definitely need to have a bit of a chat about kettlebells today.
Absolutely. I'm glad that you said that, too, because, you know, it's funny. I remember in the early days of the kettlebell, where I'm sure you remember this, too, there was like... maybe it was because of the big claims that were being made about kettlebells, most of which were true, to be very honest. But maybe it was because it was like the new kid on the block relative to, you know, the standard, you know, weight room antics. There was a lot of hate on kettlebells. You know, people would say all sorts of nasty things about them. And I think that as time has gone on and they've become a little bit more ubiquitous within the strength training world and in the West in particular, a lot of it's died down, but it's never gone away completely. So yes, I would definitely like to hear your insights on kettlebell training, because I think, like I said before we started the podcast, you and I have very, very similar approach in terms of placing an importance on movement quality. So we'll compare notes on the kettlebell for sure.
Well, just as a quick one, like the amount, because I work a lot with CrossFitters and powerlifters and weightlifters. And a lot of people do body weight and calisthenics training and stuff as well. And the amount of shoulders, just alone, just shoulders that I have fixed over the years for those people with just the bottoms up kettlebell press is insane. So it's a very, very valuable tool to have if you know how to use it in the right way. It doesn't just have to be, it's not just swings you can do with this thing. There's so many things you can do with the kettlebell, like, and just the principles of knowing how to counterbalance as well. Absolutely phenomenal, phenomenal tool.
Yeah. I'm a huge fan for that reason. I'm glad that you mentioned the bottoms up thing, because most people think it's just like sort of a party trick. You're like, oh, look at this. This is hard and I can do it, as though it's the same thing as, like, you know, doing a pistol squat on a Bosu ball or something like that. And it's something that if you use it correctly, you'd be amazed at the kind of output that you'll get in terms of not just your strength, but also your resilience. So, it makes perfect sense that you would maybe run into a lot of CrossFitters who would seem to have a lot of issues, but another story for another day. Now, I am especially curious, as I'm always curious about everybody, to learn about your origin story. And in particular, because one of my listeners, and he's also been a guest on the podcast, Jim Bain, from Scotland said that you should ask Tom about his, just a short list of his injuries, but I'm going to go one step further and I'm going to ask for the long list if there is one, because it seems that you've had your fair share and yet you're doing crazy stuff. I've seen some awesome videos of you doing some really amazing things. So what is your origin story in general, and you know, what were some of the injuries that you ended up getting along the way to trying to get fit, and then how did you overcome them?
I did type out a long list for our group at one point. Okay. I have it here. I could actually read it off as we go and mix in kind of the origins as well. So one of the reasons that I'm so passionate about what we do essentially is that I didn't have an athletic background. I hated any kind of physical exercise at school, especially. Like, I would have not brought my PE kit to school so that I would just get to sit in the change room, not have to take part. Like, I absolutely hated exercise with a passion. I just wanted to play computer games. And then whenever I got a bit older, I just wanted to drink and smoke. And that was just me, you know, and that was, I had zero interest in it. Didn't want to get fit at all. And it wasn't until a few of my friends, because then I started just over the years, obviously from being inactive, started putting on a lot of weight. And just over the years, my friends just started poking fun at me and they called me beef. And they would joke around how hard it was to get past me and stuff. And because I used to work in quite a small office. And it was that, I was like, well, I'm going to get fit then. And that's when I just started to jump straight into exercise, which was kind of like the wrong thing to do. So what I realize now, and what I really encourage people to do now, is to separate what mobility is from exercise. Mobility should be essential. And the thing you do first before you consider anything else, exercise, take it or leave it, can come and go, can do whatever you like. You can lift heavy, you can run far, you can do crossfit, you can do kettlebells, you can do whatever you want, but mobility comes first. And you need to make sure that you know how to look after your joints above all else, because if you get injured, it's going to hinder your progress, which is a lot of what I started to realize. So I didn't actually start training until my mid-20s. And at the time, I started watching the UFC. And I was like, that's pretty cool. I like that. And I seen there was a martial arts gym near me. I was like, I got my wife to hold my hand and she took me to the gym and she walked up and I went and seen the instructor. I was like, ooh. And like, I had no body awareness, no nothing. But I was just like, all right, these people seem friendly. I'm going to try and give this a go. Like, I remember my first ever class, like trying to figure out how to put someone in an armbar, and it was just so alien to like touch somebody else and all. It was just so weird. But I was like, I want to be able to do this. But then I happened to stay on and seen a class afterwards, and it was the traditional art Wing Chun, which when you see it done at quite a high level, it looks really, really cool. And it was all that stuff from the computer games that I used to play. I was like, hang on, you can do this in real life. That's class. And I was like, I want to learn that. And then, so I went from someone who was never doing anything, like no interest in exercise at all, to training 6 days a week, multiple hours a day, sometimes 5-6 hours a day. I would have been training. I would have been doing the morning classes and the evening classes, the beginner classes, and then the intermediate classes, and then the advanced classes. I would have stayed on. So this was like over a period of a year. I didn't just jump straight into the advanced classes, but I wasn't physically prepared to do any of that stuff. My hip mobility was terrible. My shoulder mobility was terrible. I just did not move well. And that was purely like, even in my upbringing. So even whenever I was growing up, like I never would have sat on the floor. It would have been a big task to me to have to get up off the floor. And like whenever me and my wife went to, I think it was Amsterdam at one point, I moaned about my hip being sore the entire time walking upstairs. And I just made the trip miserable. I was just a horrible person to be around because I was just moaning so much about how sore everything was. And then when I started training, you know, obviously the weight started coming off and I started to feel a bit stronger and stuff, but I just kept tweaking things and tweaking things and tweaking things. And so it was really one of the first ones on my list here was chronic left hip pain. My left hip was always sore. And then as I started getting training, I was doing Muay Thai, I was doing wrestling, I was doing Wing Chun, and I was doing multiple private lessons a week as well. I was training at home, always doing sneaky push-ups and stuff and practicing my martial arts forms and stuff at home. And I was making tons of progress. It was, you know, there was people that had been there training for 5-6 years that I was like overtaking in skill level and stuff, because I was just training so much harder than everybody else. And just that was me. I was like, well, I've to make up for lost time here. And I just battered myself. So I got away with it for a good year. But what I essentially did was like just hurry up the process. So what happens to a lot of people over like a 5 or 10 year period, whenever, if they're not addressing their mobility, things start to hurt. And then they're, you know, then you start going to your physio all the time. And you end up costing yourself a fortune in massages, and you start buying all the weird tools and stuff and start doing weird S&M techniques to yourself and, you know, poking yourself with balls and rubbing yourself in rollers. And then, you know, your warm-ups start to become like an hour long. You have to get to the gym first for an hour before you start to class to warm up, you know. And I guess it was me in my mid-20s, like I was horrible at moving. And there's people that come to me now for one-to-ones that would be in their 60s, and they're like, oh, I'm terrible at this, I'm terrible at that. And I'm like, you have no idea how bad I was when I was in 25. I was like, you're fantastic compared to what I was like, you know. And which is something like a lot of people try and chalk stuff off to age, but it's all just your habits. And the only time that age can really become a factor is if you have 10 or 20, 30 years of just bad habits racked up. Whereas if you take your mobility seriously and just always look after your joints, there's no reason you can't be moving really, really well. Like some people that are using our SMM program, they're in their 70s and they're like doing full depth squats all the way down, and they're moving absolutely incredible. And there's people in the bookies, the betting office that I used to work in, that were in their 50s, and you were like, they just ripped themselves off. They were like, oh, I'm done. So yeah, so some of the injuries that I started to pick up in my journey was, I had started off with chronic left hip pain, and then in Muay Thai I ended up with a meniscus tear, which had to eventually be removed because my knee was just swollen for the best part of a year. It took that long to actually get the operation. After that, I ended up with patella tendonitis on and off for years, and that was purely, it was never pointed out to me, no matter how many people I ever went to for assessments and stuff, how bad my hip rotation was on my right side. So my right knee actually points inwards towards my left knee, then my left knee goes forwards. It's improved a lot over the years, but it's still, you know, to a certain extent, my right hip is still more internally rotated than my left hip would be. So I would always need to, when I'm doing my own mobility work, I would always need to spend a bit more time on my right hip. And that's a really important thing for people to learn, because everybody's different and everyone will have their own little quirks that they need to work around. And it's so important to learn that stuff, because you can't just, you know, if you're doing a rehab program or whatever, it's like, oh, do lunges each side, you know, and it's like, well, it's not addressing the issue with your right hip that's going on. So you might want to be on top of that and then do your lunges. So it's a really important thing to do things in the right order. So I then injured my right shoulder really badly. I don't know what I did to it, but I could not lift my arm. I had frozen shoulder. I couldn't lift my arm at all. And I was like, it'll be fine. And I kept showing up to the classes and just hugging it to my body and I was trying to spar in the classes. I'm like, hey, I'm fine, I'm fine, I'm fine. You're like, why are you not using your right arm? But I just kept going anyway, because I was addicted to training. I actually got addicted to training. So I never got checked out. It gradually started to get better. I found a really good physio at that point that I really, really like and really value his opinion. He trains martial arts as well. And he helped me get the range of motion back on my shoulder within like one session. And there was other people that I'd went to before, and they tried to sign me up for 8-week things, and they were giving me these really useless exercises. And this guy just really showed me the importance of like opening up your upper back to help a shoulder. And I was like, everything was coming from my locked up upper back. And then I started to realize why my shoulder flexion was so bad. It wasn't, I was trying to stretch my shoulders, but it was my upper back that was the problem. And that's the mistake that most people are making when it comes to trying to work on the shoulders. You should always start from the thoracic spine and work your way out. So yeah, after I'd fixed my right shoulder, I thought, and ended up with left side shoulder impingement, because I was then compensating because I did all this good stuff for my right shoulder but didn't do anything for the left shoulder. Whenever you're rehabbing an exercise and you learn good exercises to rehab your shoulder, do it with both shoulders. Don't just do it with one. I ended up then having chronic neck pain, and it kept going left to right. Every few weeks I would tweak my neck really badly, and I'd be turning like Batman. Hopefully everyone knows what I mean by that. You know, your body turns with you, your whole head has to come with you. You can't you know, move your neck. I fractured my right radius. I ended up with right forearm tendonitis. I tore fascia in my left lower back, which was extremely painful, and that was sore for about 3 weeks. And I was like twice a week to the physio getting rubbed out, and I realigned my pelvis. So if I was standing up straight, my pelvis was off to the right side, and my right knee was actually bent, and I had a curve. So I was really lean at this time. Like I had a, you know, you could see my abs at this point, you know, which was nice at the time. And but you could actually see like a C curve in my abs. Like I was actually, my physio was jokingly calling me Banana Man. And that took me all the fix. And then I had recurring back pain. I kept coming back. And then I had really bad knee pain. And then I ended up with plantar fasciitis in my foot as well. And then my worst one that I got was when I was doing a back squat. So I delved into the root of mobility of all the foam rolling stuff, and, you know, using the band of distractions in the hip and everything, you know, all the stuff that's really, really popular to see. And that was kind of the route I was taking. And I was making improvements to my flexibility. My squat was getting deeper and stuff, but I wasn't taking any approach towards stability or strength through full ranges. It was just like, let's pull on this till I get lower. And that was how I was trying to work on things at that time. And then I wasn't able to squat without any kind of heel elevation at all. But then I'd got myself to a point where I could actually squat with my heels flat down on the ground in flat shoes. And I started back squatting heavy all the time. And I was like, this is great. And then I was coming up from a heavy 3-rep max one day, and I felt a boop, boop, boop like that in my spine. And I thought, oh, my back's went again. And I thought, well, I'll get an appointment with my physio, and I text him saying, here, have you got anything this week? I've tweaked my back here, I think. And it was just starting to get warmer and gradually like weirder throughout the evening. And then when I went to bed that night and woke up the next day, I couldn't put my left foot in the ground, screaming, couldn't stand up straight. It was so, so, so bad. And I had to lie down in the back of my wife's car. She drove me to the physio, who's a great physio. I went in, I got up to him, and he said, dude, I can't touch you. Like, with the symptoms you have right now, I cannot, you know, you need to go and get a scan. You need to go to hospital. And I was, it was like, you fixed me before. What's going on here? But the symptoms I was presenting were classic disc injury symptoms. So over this period of a year, I improved my flexibility better, made my stability better. We'll go into this stuff more and how I kind of did stuff. But it was over this period of a year that I then fixed myself, essentially. It was completely pain-free, training better than ever. I was maxing out better in all of my lifts. My form was so much better. My body awareness was so much better. And then I got my letter came through from the hospital to go and get my MRI scan. And I was like, well, if we did this long, I'm going to go get it anyway, even though I was pain-free. So at that time, I thought that it must have just been a tweak or a slipped disc. I thought that discs could slip, and that's what I thought it was. Oh, it must have slipped back in then. And that's what my knowledge was at the time, and that's what I thought, well, must have happened. You know, I'm fixed now. Everything must have healed up. It's all grand. And then I went and got my MRI scan, and then when I got the results, it showed an L4, L5 disc protrusion, and with L4 nerve root compression, and an L5 S1 large paracentral disc extrusion, which causes flattening of the left side of the thecal sac, as well as posterior displacement and flattening of the transversing left S1 nerve root. There's also potential irritation of the exiting L5 nerve root at this level. And that showed up on the MRI report. And I was pain-free when I got that. I was like, and I went in to see the specialist, and he says, you're going to need to think about a career change and all this stuff. And I was like, I'm fine. What gives here? And that really got me into starting to research more. I'm like, why are people like walking around with like a mini disc bulge, scared to move? And there's other people that have like what I have or worse, and they're totally fine. And it was purely down to the treatment that they received and the stuff that they were told at the time and the movement habits that they have as well. So if someone has terrible flexibility, like they can't touch their toes, they can't sit on the floor cross-legged, things like that, and a disc injury, it might just be that combination of the disc injury and a bad hip flexibility. And if they fix the hip flexibility, they could be pain-free. It is not a simple process. You can have many setbacks as well along the way. Like I did, there was 3 major setbacks where I thought, oh, I'm not getting better here. This is, oh, I've caused more damage. They were all the thoughts running through my head at that time, but they were all like a learning curve. Each time they happened, I was able to go back to the movements and bring myself back to where I was quicker and quicker and quicker. Each time I had a setback, I was able to get better quicker. So it went from being like a period of a month to get better, to a couple of weeks to get better, to a few days to get better, to then knowing the warning signs or the triggers in my mind, essentially, that would give me a really bad flare up with back pain. I was able to go, I know how to get rid of this, like within 20 minutes. I know the exact movements to do, how to breathe and relax myself. And that's a trainable skill, which isn't talked about enough. People don't talk that you know how to actually get rid of pain through moving, and it's a trainable skill. It's scary as all else whenever you first start trying to do it, but it is something you can hone, just like getting stronger at the deadlift. You can train yourself to get out of pain faster just through learning how to breathe properly, learn how to move properly, and the understanding that you have. Because if you're walking around going, oh, I'm going to cause more damage, you're going to believe that you're going to cause more damage. Whereas if you go, this is just a muscle spasm and it's trying to protect an old injury that thinks it's still a problem, but my body has learned how to adapt to it. Oh, right. Okay. And then you'll actually start to relax yourself. And then your body will relax. But that's not a simple process. You can't just go, oh, no, it's definitely fine. It takes practice of actually moving through the pain. So yeah, that's kind of like my history in a nutshell of how I ended up with all the things that I did, and then why I started coaching the way that I did it as well.
Yeah, I think that's, I think anybody who has ever suffered through an injury and has questioned, am I ever going to be able to do what I want to do again, would do themselves a favor to hear a story like that. Because, you know, on some level, on a major level, I don't really blame people for asking that question, because it's like, that's what they hear. Their doctor says, you're not gonna be able to do this anymore. Their surgeon says, you're not gonna be able to do that. And it's not like these people are lying. It's not like they're wrong in every case. But, you know, one of the things that people forget is they forget that, number one, doctors have a certain specialty. And outside of that, like they can be forgiven for not knowing that there are other options or other possibilities. I think they should still learn that, you know, that, well, maybe you need to see a movement specialist because medically there's nothing more I can really tell you. Likewise with a surgeon. And people don't seem to have an issue with saying, okay, well, this personal trainer thinks that all I have to do is move and I'm going to get better. And that couldn't possibly be the answer for everything, which is true. There are certain times where, you know, like a surgical intervention is absolutely needed, or that maybe not moving around a whole lot for a period of time might be the right answer. But yeah, people seem to feel like they have, like, once they've gotten injured, they're sentenced to not being able to move anymore, not being able to overcome or surpass. And it couldn't be further from the truth. But I like what you said, that it really does come down to learning how to move and learning in particular the skills that are necessary. Not only, you know, like, here are the things that I have to do to make myself feel better, but also here are the warning signs that I missed before because I thought there were just some anomaly, as opposed to my body telling me, this is happening now. The next chain of events is going to be this, this, and this. So you react early on, and then you can, it's like, you know, on a railroad, you can just change the direction that the train ends up going. You know what I mean? Now, when you started doing this, was this all just like self-taught? I mean, again, you seem like very much an upstart when it comes to, like, you find something you like, such as martial arts, and you dive right in. Was that the case with learning how to get back in, you know, in to a level where you could be resilient? Or did you work with this physical therapist and, you know, get his insights? Did you, you know, work with doctors, other movement mentors? Like, what did you do to start tipping the scales more in your favor?
It was a really gradual process. So I kind of learned one thing at a time. Now, when I work with someone now, I'm like, we need to check these 13 things to make sure that you're okay, and to see where there's any weakness. Whereas it was like, over that period of year, I gradually learned one thing at a time. So for me, it was like, one of the first things was like, my right hip is terrible. It does not move the same way as my left one does at all. How am I going to fix this? So that's when I started to think more. I would use this like hashtag sometimes of like, think joints, not muscles. Mm-hmm. And it was really like, the joint's not moving properly. It doesn't, like, is it my piriformis? Is it my, you know, is it my hamstrings? Is it my psoas? Is it this? Is it that? You know, and the things that people like latch onto, it's like, oh, I have this really tight psoas. And I'm like, well, we'll fix it then. What's the problem? You know, it's not something you should have. You shouldn't be walking around for 3 years going, I have a tight psoas. You know, we'll fix it then. What's the problem? It's more on the actual joint movement itself. So the thing about hips is that they should externally rotate, internally rotate, extend, flex. You should be able to abduct and adduct really well. Do all those things. And what most people do whenever they have anything wrong with the back of their hip is that they'll come across the likes of glute bridges and they'll come across the likes of clamshells, which is extension and abduction. And it's like, okay, are you going to do any of the other things? Have you ever done external or internal hip rotation? Some people will have done the pigeon stretch. They'll have done the external hip rotation, but they'll have not worked on the internal hip rotation at all. And then the likes of adduction, like the Copenhagen plank, just supporting yourself with the inner thigh. Like, the amount of people that can hold themselves up in a side plank and support themselves with the outside of the leg, but can't lift that bottom leg up and support themselves with the inside of the leg is crazy. And then they're like, they're wanting to squat with weight. And it's like, you can't even hold yourself up. That's a big thing. So it sounds quite rude to say that. But like, to me, that's the way I like to boil mobility movements down to that. Like, what does that do? Well, a side plank, can you hold yourself up? And there's so many people that I've met over the years that cannot do a side plank at all. And they're trying to lift heavy weights. They're trying to do CrossFit. They're trying to Olympic weightlift. And it's like, you can't hold yourself up under your own body weight. You're never going to get yourself to the numbers that you want to hit in the future if you can't hold yourself up. So it's kind of like the way. And when you kind of say that, people are like, all right, okay, maybe I see the importance of this again. Rather than just being like, oh, side planks are stupid, they bore me. You know, it's like, no, it's actually super important that you're able to do that exercise. So yeah, hips as a whole, like, it's such an important thing to make sure that they're moving well in all directions. And it's okay to have one hip slightly tighter than the other. But if you have a major difference on one side to the other, then like every squat you do is going slightly sideways. And as well, like I said about lunges earlier on as well, every lunge you do will also be slightly sideways. So it's not just a case of like, oh, you need to do unilateral exercises then. It's the, if the joint itself isn't moving properly, then you may as well be doing those sideways squats instead of the lunges. They're not going to help at that point. So you need to improve how the joint actually moves first. Then those things start to become more beneficial for you. And then you're actually going to get the benefits from them. And in terms of the shoulders as well, I started to learn about the upper back and how bad my upper back was as well. and then the stability of the shoulders too on top of that, and actually, you know, moving the shoulders in all the directions they can move as well. So internal, external rotation as well, adduction, abduction. Shoulders are basically hips as well. So, but the shoulder has even more mobility. So it's so important to focus on stability when it comes to the shoulders. Otherwise they can actually feel tight. And a lot of people miss that. They're wondering, you know, I'm stretching all the time, why do I still feel tight? And it's the stability stuff that they miss, and especially when it comes to hypermobility as well. People that are too flexible, if they already have all of those ranges there, they need to work on strengthening those ranges, not avoid them. It's one of the worst things in the world. So my business partner, Jenny, she's hypermobile. She has access to all these crazy ranges of stuff she can do. She can drop down in the splits whenever she wants. She can do all these things, crazy back bends and all that other stuff, but still would feel tight and have pain. But as she, over the years, has worked on strength, stability, balance, building all them things up together, then she's able to now use that like hyperflexibility in really cool ways, you know. And it's, you know, it just takes time. You know, she talked about her background before, and it's, that was over a period of 8 years. It took her to do all this cool stuff, and like she trains backflips now and stuff, whereas before she couldn't walk around town for too long, her shins hurt, you know. So it's there's always a way to build yourself up. And for a lot of people, it's just finding out that starting point. A lot of people just don't know where to start. So for me, I needed to go right back to, like, I can't move my hip at all. Let's fix that first before I start even thinking about looking at squats again. And that's kind of, it's where a lot of people need to start. If they're very, very inflexible, it's like, make the joints work, check each side and see, are they moving well, and see, are they stable through their full range of motion as well? And that's kind of the way I started to think. And I get, quote unquote, lucky a lot of times just by assessing those things with people. And it's like, I've been doing, a lot of people say to me, like, I've tried everything. And I'm like, well, have you tried doing all of the motions of your hip regularly? And I'm like, well, I haven't tried that. And it's like, well, let's give that a go. And, you know, just through doing that, you know, I see sciatica going away, piriformis syndrome going away, lower back pain going away, disc pain symptoms going away, knee pain symptoms going away, just from doing those things with the hips that I mentioned there, just working on all the ranges of the hips, not having to go, oh, let's try these hip flexor exercises and see if that works. Oh, that didn't work. Okay, let's try strengthening your hamstrings. Okay, that didn't work. You know, it's like, just do it all, do the whole thing. It doesn't take as long as you think. It's, in fact, it's easier. I find, rather than doing like 5 sets of 10 of like wee step down exercises and weird things as well. So just over the course of, like I said, a year, I just started to realize how bad like my one side was compared to my other. And there was just, there was differences with everything. My right shoulder as well was like so much more stable than my left shoulder, and that's why I kept tweaking my neck as well, because I was always using barbells. And yet my hips were absolutely awful. I had no concept of what core strength was as well. So it's what I like to do with the way that I coach as well, and like our videos, is just boil everything down to, can you do this? No, work on it then. It's just practice and you'll get better at it. There's no magic secret technique out there. It's like, okay, you struggle with balance, let's get you balancing more. You find that a bit easier, let's find a harder balance in exercise for you then, you know. So you're always trying to challenge yourself that wee bit further, and you will just build yourself up. You'll just build up your resilience over time. And it's just that, always, how can I make it a wee bit harder? Just having that in the back of your head all the time. So when you get kind of good at something, how can I make it a wee bit harder? And sometimes it's just like, oh, go slower, you know, change the tempo or change the range a bit, you know, or go deeper, pause in the bottom position, some things like that. Not everything needs to be this linear, like add weight or add reps. You can get, you know, you can change the elements of something quite easily. So yeah, that was what I started to realize then, was like how important all this stuff was to me. And it was like, and then everyone I was working with, I'm like, they have this problem too. They just haven't ran into the issues that I've ran into yet, because they were, you know, only training like a sensible person a few times a week. So I was like, let's work on this stuff so that you don't ever run into those issues. And you just started to notice with people, if I got them doing like a mini morning routine and just working on these imbalances that they maybe had, it was just so much easier as a coach for me. It was like the people weren't coming in going, oh, this is sore, that's sore. And then you're having to change your programming for them and stuff. It's like when you give them that bit of body awareness, and then they start to come to you going, you know, I have really noticed this is tight or whatever, and it's got a lot better over the period of weeks. And it's like, great, yeah, let's keep going with our squats then, let's keep getting you stronger, you know. Because it's the worst thing as a coach, if you're not interested in mobility and stuff as well, and you want to get people stronger and fitter or help them lose weight and stuff, it's like you don't want to have to fix them all the time. Whereas if you do it right the first time, like within, you know, your first few months of working with someone and just address all of those little things, you can be helping that person for the next 10 years and not run into any issues. You know, maybe the odd wee tweak or something like that, but no major injuries or recurring things as well. If something keeps coming back and coming back, it's like, right, what have you missed? You've got to figure that out. You can't just keep trying to ply on through, which is the thing that I tried to do. You know, it was like, oh, that's sore, well, I'll just rest it completely then and just do upper body for a while. It's like, oh, hang on, why does that keep getting sore? That's what you need to start thinking.
Yeah. You know, there seems like, I think there's a big disconnect that a lot of people have with their bodies. And, you know, one of them that really comes to mind, particularly when you're telling some of these stories, you talked about how everybody's got something that they're going to need to work on. And I think people forget that they're an individual. Like, they want to do these cool workouts. They want to jump into, you know, a CrossFit class and do like the, you know, the clean and jerk. They want to do muscle ups. But they don't think about like, okay, well, what are the people who are doing this successfully and safely? Like, what are some of the things that they can do that I can't? How can I individualize it to me? So on the one hand, you've got people who understand that and people who seek that out. But on the other hand, I think you've got people who maybe have a similar mentality to like what you started off with, where you were like, I've got to make up for lost time. So I just got to get in there and I got to start hammering away. And they start to find the limits that they were seeking, and they don't realize that those limits aren't like, okay, I can't lift anymore now. I guess I should work on it. It's like, oh, I can't move anymore. My hip hurts so bad, or, you know, my shoulder keeps me up at night. And what I think a lot of it really breaks down to is, and I'm sure you'll agree with me on this, is that as much as I love exercise and all the cool exercises that, you know, we like to post on Instagram and stuff like that, exercise is ultimately a supplement for the movement that we don't get in our day-to-day lives. You know, like, we're able to exercise, but we're made to move. So if that very baseline ability to move, like you pointed out, moving the hip in all the different directions and through all of its ranges of motion, if you don't have that sort of a thing and you're adding this supplement, it's similar to having, like, I don't know, going to McDonald's three times a day and then being like, oh, but I'm going to take a vitamin supplement because I want to be healthy, you know? It's like, you should probably address those eating habits before you start thinking about the supplements. They're not going to be all that helpful until you've got the base level habits down. So when people start making these changes, what are some of the reactions that you notice with them, with those, we'll call them the supplements, like their exercises? So their, you know, their squats, their lunges, their presses, they start to notice that not only do they feel better, but are they also noticing maybe they can lift heavier? And all of a sudden, like, they're like, oh, I have these abilities I never even knew. And it's just because I opened up my thoracic spine, or I opened up my hips. Is that something you see pretty often when you train people?
Absolutely. Yeah. Whenever someone starts to like care about their movement, which unfortunately is something that for a lot of people, they don't care until they hurt something first. Like, your first injury can almost be your gateway into actually caring about your mobility, which is something that we really want to change. We want to make you think that, you know, if you nail the mobility stuff first, you're not going to run into any of these silly roadblocks that are just completely avoidable. But yeah, whenever you start to care more about your body, improve your body awareness as well, and be like, what does that do when that does that? You are easier to teach. It's easier for you to learn new things as well. And especially, you know, I was an Olympic weightlifting coach for such a long time. If I give people more body awareness, teaching them the lifts was so much easier. Whereas if someone was just trying to learn how to snatch whenever they didn't know where their elbow was, it was like, you know, nearly impossible. So just through that, they just get better at learning stuff all the time. Because the more things that you learn, the more new things you learn, the better you get at learning more new things. People aren't just clumsy. They're not just uncoordinated. It's just that they haven't practiced taking in new information and trying to process it. And the more that you do that, the better that you get at doing that. And the faster you get at doing that as well. So the more things you learn, the more stuff you're able to learn quicker as well, which is really, really cool. And yeah, the strength gains that you would notice with people, and just their ability to be able to see out a program when they're moving well as well. And the recovery is too. You know, we have so many like runners and lifters in our group that, like, just after doing, you know, our stuff for a few months, they're like, I'm not ending up a sore after training anymore at all. And it's like, yeah, but you're actually moving efficiently now. Imagine if you were always just slightly moving joints slightly wrong all of the time. And, you know, you might not feel it. Well, your perception of what is supposed to feel right is your own perception of what is supposed to feel right. You don't know any different, but your body all the time is slightly compensating, and it's exhausting. It really, really is exhausting. Your body's having to fight to not let something cave in so much even more. And it's really, really tiring, really draining on your body. So it's going to hinder your recovery. Whereas, you know, for example, for me, anytime I used to squat, it used to hurt my knees, hurt my lower back. And I would just feel my quads after the session. And I just thought, I hate squats that hurt your knees, you know, don't they? And, you know, some people would agree with me, some people like, what? You know, but now every time I squat, I feel my quads, I feel my adductors, I feel my hamstrings, and I feel my glutes, and I love them. In fact, I feel my midsection more on, more stable. You know, there's nothing, especially as for someone that went through chronic pain for such a long time with back pain, there's nothing better than feeling strong, like actually feeling like the exercise you did made you feel strong at the time. And then for the rest of the like next few days after, that is an amazing feeling compared to how I used to feel after training. Like I used to be dragging my feet, like not able to function throughout the day. Your training should not do that to you. You should be leaving the gym feeling like you can flip a car, not walking out going, oh no, I don't want to have to do that again, and having to take a week off in between training sessions. That's madness, you know? And that just comes down to a lot of people's just ability to move. And when you move more efficiently, you recover better, you get stronger faster, and your body loves it. It's like, oh, nom, 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 nom. It loves to move. Whereas, and you'll be more motivated to move as well. Whereas if you are sore all of the time and it just drains the life out of you to train, your motivation is not going to be there. You're going to be like, oh, I have to go to the gym today. And it just becomes about weight loss or whatever, or, you know, because you have to, and oh, I have to be healthy. Whereas when you move well, you absolutely love it. You can't wait to get up and do stuff and move around and get to the gym and train with your friends and do all that there stuff, you know? And that comes from movement first. And that was why, even for me, I was like, for even diet and stuff, it's like, I don't know enough about it anyway, and I don't want to teach that stuff. I'm like, if I can make someone move really well, they'll fix their own diet because they'll be so motivated, they love the train, that the other stuff will just come off the back of that, you know? So that was, for me, it was like always movement first, fix the movement first, and everything else will just improve off the back of that.
Yeah, I couldn't agree more. I think one of the big things, there's like, again, mentioned earlier about disconnects, and one of those disconnects is like moving and exercising because it's actually fun. Like, you know, it's not uncommon for somebody to find out, you know, like, oh, that you're working out or whatever, and they'll be like, oh, what are you training for? As though there's just some sort of like an end goal, like with a finite date, and then when that's over, you're no longer training. It's like you do it because you enjoy it, and it's like fun. You feel motivated to do it, and you don't need to like motivate yourself, like give yourself a pump up speech or whatever. It's just something that you look forward to doing and just can't wait to do. But I think that a lot of people do miss it because what you mentioned about like leaving the gym after a hard session of squats and you feel like, you know, you feel like you got hit by a train and not like you've actually done some effective training. A lot of people think that's what they're supposed to do because they hear these things like no pain, no gain, you know, go hard or go home, give it 110%. So part of it is, I think, the philosophy that they go in with because they see these Nike ads or God knows what. And, you know, and then they follow their favorite influencers who are again, influencing them perhaps in the wrong direction. And then they're adding that onto the fact that they sit 12 hours a day because they work in an office and, you know, they haven't been physically active since elementary school. And it's very easy for people to ignore those warning signs. You know, like you mentioned this earlier, you get these warning signs that let you know, okay, you might want to change course because something bad's about to happen. Most of them think that's what's supposed to happen. And so then they get injured and they think, well, it's something that I did. I'm just not good enough. I'm not cut out for this sort of a thing. But no, you gotta move before you gotta walk before you can run. And a lot of people just want to go from sitting to running immediately, you know, in a manner of speaking. And I think it's certainly a huge mistake. So what are some of the, the biggest aha moments that you have had over the last couple of years in training people that have really gotten, that have streamlined your approach, that have made everything that you do to help people much, much easier? Is there anything in particular where you were just like, of course, this summarizes everything. This is exactly the road most people need to take. Let's start down this path.
Oh, I like it. Stretch when you're stiffest would be one thing. And everyone is stiffest first thing in the morning. No pun intended. The thing that
they're supposed to be anyway,
want to be thinking about is training yourself out of, yeah, well, it's supposed to be. The thing you want to think about is training yourself to stretch when you're stiffest, because then you're getting rid of that habit. Whereas if you wake up first thing in the morning and you're like, and you're trailing your feet and you go and you make your coffee and then you go and you sit in the car and then you sit all day and then you go to the gym in the evening, you have just let yourself be stiff all day. Whereas if you just take an extra 5 or 10 minutes first thing in the morning, it doesn't have to be fancy. You don't have to get a sweat on. It's just moving your joints like joints first thing in the morning. Start at the head, work your way down to the shoulders, do a bit of spine rotation stuff, do a bit of hip rotation stuff, sit on the floor, move your ankles a bit, do a bit of balance, and then go about your day. It doesn't have to be fancy at all. In fact, you can still do it with your eyes closed, and it needs to be attainable. as well. If you start saying to yourself, I'm going to do a 1 hour yoga practice every morning for the next 6 months, and you haven't got up early in the past 20 years, you're not going to stick to it. Whereas most people can generally go, all right, 5 minutes, fine. But the more that you do that, the more you become that person that wakes up in the morning going, ah, and can just touch your toes straight away. And especially for me, coming from my history of chronic back pain and waking up, like I used to be scared of them. I used to wake up petrified in the morning because I knew how painful it was going to be for me until I started to get moving a bit. And it would have been a couple of hours before I would have been able to function properly. So for me, going through that experience now, I love waking up every morning and moving and being like touching my toes. So one of the things I do as soon as I get out of bed, I'll just roll over onto the bed frame and start doing dips on the bed frame, sit myself down in my hips as much as I can, move my hips around in like an assisted squat. So I'm still holding myself up at this point. I'm not just doing squats for reps. I'm just still holding myself up, just moving myself into my hips. And then I go and I, you know, have my morning pee, have my coffee and all that other stuff. And it's just that, you know, you want to wake up ready to move. And the more you practice that, the more your brain goes, oh, right, okay, we'll do this then. And you wake up, your muscles are then going, you know, they're ready to move. You're training yourself out of that stiffness. And that's something that everyone can learn. So it's a really, really good thing to have. And then on top of that, just starting to be aware of what needs improved and how you can improve it, so that whenever you're doing like more focused mobility work, say in your warm-ups or like as a separate session, that you're like, right, I need to spend, in my case, like more time opening my right hip. And because I have nerve impingement on my left side, I need to spend more time activating my left glute. I need to do more exercises that make my left glute do something because I cannot feel it. It's just, it feels like it's not there to me because of just the nerves. And I need to make sure that I keep on top of balance. And that's a big thing as well. Like it's boiling it down to like, what's important, like when you're 90, what's going to be important to you? Not falling over. So when do you want to start working on balance? Yesterday, so that you never lose it. And that is, you know, it's a cliche thing to say, you know, if you don't, you know, use it or lose it kind of thing, but it is really, really true. The better you can get yourself moving now at this point, the easier it is to maintain. The longer you put that off, you say, like, where do you want to be in the next year, the next 10 years? Think with the habits you have now, are you going to feel happy with where you're at in that time period? Or do you want to change your habits now? So in that year or those 10 years, are you moving the way you want to move? And that's just, it's a really good motivational thing because some people are just stuck not knowing how to start. But it's like, you know, think about that, really sit down, no music on, no phone, and go, right, what am I going to be like in a year if I keep doing what I'm doing now? And you'll probably think of a few things that you can improve on. And then it's just about finding that knowledge. Find the knowledge and then action on it. Actually start to put it into practice in a way that suits you. There's so many ways to improve things. You got to find the one that excites you. And that's kind of why we put a lot of humor and stuff into our videos. You know, make it fun. It doesn't have to be serious. You don't need to go, oh, I need to do my stretches today. You know, and that's the kind of why we came up with like a term, flong and sexible. It's like you want to get strong and flexible, put them together. Yeah, there you get that flong, and a lot of people say it's stretchable, but sexible is funny, you know. And don't take yourself seriously, you know what I mean? You can enjoy a challenge, enjoy competitions, enjoy chasing medals and all that other stuff, but you gotta enjoy moving as well. And the worst people that I ever see are the people that do take themselves so seriously and that they're really stressed out and stuff. They move like a solid fridge, whereas when you finally go, well, I'm probably fine, everything just starts to move better on its own anyway, because you finally relaxed yourself. You know, you can't force yourself into relaxing. You got to learn how to just go, meh, it's probably fine, you know, because everybody's got something going on. Everyone's messed up in some way, but most people are probably fine, you know, so you can try and improve things, but don't get obsessive about it.
Yeah, I think that's a great message because a lot of people do have a lot of hangups about their body. They've got hangups about their abilities. And if they're constantly around people who, or they're following people, for instance, who just take the whole thing way too seriously, they take themselves way too seriously, it just sucks the fun out of it. And, you know, a big part of the thing that's going to keep people coming back, it's like, think, why do people sit down and watch, you know, a binge on Netflix or watch TV until it's time to go to bed? Because it's more entertaining to them. You know, people like the sense that they're doing something that's enjoyable. And obviously the main difference is that TV or Netflix or whatever is something that's just pure entertainment. They're probably not actually getting anything tangible out of it. But if you can apply that same approach to like entertainment and joy and enjoyment to your training, that's something you actually can get something out of. you know, provided that you've got the proper focus and you've got forward intent. So yeah, I couldn't agree more. In fact, I didn't mention this earlier, but I remember seeing one of your Facebook ads maybe a year or so ago. And normally I see a Facebook ad, I watch 5 seconds and I'm like, I've seen enough. And yours was close to 4 minutes and I watched the entire thing. And I was like, wow, this was really fun. Like, you know, like I like what this guy's doing. He's obviously not taking himself too seriously. And yeah, I mean, that mentality, that philosophy you have has changed a lot of people's lives. And at a minimum, it has created the phrase flong and sexible, which I think that you deserve eternal credit for, because that's it's a very, very good term, very useful. And who doesn't want to be sexable? Let's be honest. You know,
I know, right?
It should be a high priority on anybody's list. So, Tom, where can people find you? Oh, you know what? Before we get to that, I want to ask, because I mentioned to Tracy Middendorf that I would ask this question on for her on this podcast. And well, two of them. One of them was, how would you recommend combining something like your end range program with, and she asked specifically with one of my programs, but I said, well, you know, he's probably not very familiar with my program. So we'll say strength programs in general, like what, how, and I'm not familiar with end range. So you can feel free to modify that question or tweak it to give it the proper answer that you would like. But what do you think?
I would take the elements. So if you want to use end range more as a mobility idea, the strength A workouts are very much based on improving your balance and improving your stability. So they're not going to take as much out of you as the strength B workouts. So if you want to use end ranges more as an assistance program, you can change it that way. So that you're, you know, getting all the elements of basically like SMM enhanced. Basically, you're starting to use weight for the stability elements. So using those alongside the workouts, kettlebell workouts, is absolutely fine. In fact, that's something that I would do myself as well. I would combine it with like just pure weightlifting workouts. So I would still do those more stability based workouts and the band resistance band stay, and I would still do some ring work. So I'm still, you know, hitting all those nice things that keep the joints and the spine and everything feeling happy and getting all the benefits of end range. And then yeah, push yourself with your kettlebell training or the sport that you love to do. You know, so that you're using it more as a supplementary program rather than sticking to it as a straight strict program as its own with the strength B workouts. They take energy to do, they take it out of you. They're your main workouts. So you can just supplement those out and use the other training you're doing. So the likes of your programs, you can slot them in totally fine so that you're actually going to push yourself with them. You don't want to accidentally do too much stuff. So it's absolutely fine to alter a program to suit what you want to do most, and never be afraid as well to like reduce the sets of something. So especially with a lot of stability stuff, it's like two sets is better than no sets, at least, you know. So it's completely fine to change things that way to suit it to your own time frame as well, which is it's a big way of how I train now. Like I train with a lot of different friends now and they're all doing different programs, so I'm like, right, what are you doing today? And I'll change the weights if I need to, or change it to suit what I've kind of done that week, and I'll still essentially have done it. I'll train with like three different people, and over that period of a week, still do all of the body bits that I need to do with doing three different types of programs, just because I know what I need to do myself. So it's just keep that in mind of your own kind of program. It's like, have I not done anything that, you know, works on squats this week? I'll throw in a squat session, you know, I'll make sure I'm hitting those things. The great thing about kettlebell training is it's usually going to be full body elements that you're going to be doing as well. So yeah, you can use it as a supplementary program and that'll be totally fine.
Fantastic. And then the other one that she asked, which I think I'd be very curious your response on this too. She said that her husband is very physically active, and but not with formal training, but you know, he still keeps himself active, but he's going to be undergoing meniscus surgery. So what are your recommendations for things that he can do? And she didn't mention whether it was before or after the surgery, but given the fact that you've had at least one meniscus just completely, you know, obliterated, what have you found that was helpful, or what are some of the things that just in general he should keep in mind?
For now, if it's before surgery, then work on the hip as much as possible, just improving the hip range. You've got like the likes of the hip cars drill, the 90-90 position, anything like that. Resistance band stuff as well, just keep the hip active. From our YouTube channel as well, there's the banded march drill. It's quite nice because it doesn't bend the knee fully if it's uncomfortable to do so. So focus on the things above and below the knee. So your foot strength as well. And we have a really nice foot follow along video on YouTube too. It's a great thing to do. So those elements there that you can do around the knee before surgery is great. After surgery, it's all about trying to restore the full range of motion again as well. The clockwork hips drill, that we have on YouTube. It's just literally rocking back and forward, moving the knee through its full range of motion. Over time, you want to get that so that it matches the other knee that doesn't have any issues yet. Or it may even so, you might need to improve both knees, which is the great thing about mobility. But yeah, and then starting to bring those elements of the hip stuff and the foot stuff that you've done back in with full lunges, with split squats and just getting yourself not afraid to move the knee again. Okay, so you can have bits taken out of you all the time and be totally fine afterwards, as long as you work on the strength and stability. If you just rest it and hope it's going to get better without any work, you're going to end up with a bad knee. So don't let that happen to you. So get it moving as soon as you've got the okay to return the exercise. So you'll probably get a few exercises to do after the operation and they'll get you so far. But that's what I find with a lot of stuff with a lot of people after ops. They get them so far, and that far is usually just enough to watch Netflix. It's not enough to actually, you know, function again or train, or, you know, even just if you don't even enjoy exercise, just going for long walks. People don't get enough full joint movement and full joint strength back again, that the knee then will not be a problem anymore. So it's really important that you do rehab it fully. Like, think in terms of 6 months to a year, not like, you know, 6 weeks or 12 weeks. Think more long, long, long term. And then it's, like I said earlier, it's much easier to maintain something.
Very nice. Very nice. Well, this has been a fascinating chat. I am very, very glad that I had you on. I'll have to do this again sometime. I think that the kind listeners are going to agree. This is very, very good. And I'm going to return to my question that I was about to ask a few minutes ago. Where can people follow you online? Where can they keep up to date with all the fun stuff that you're doing? And if somebody does want to get started on one of your programs, which, this is like three questions in one, which one would you then recommend? So we'll start follow and, you know, what you're up to, and then what they should do if they want to get started on one of these programs.
We didn't talk about kettlebells. What's your top two favorite kettlebell exercises?
Okay, that's a very good question. Mine, this is a tough one because I'm like a Turkish sultan in when it comes to kettlebells. I love them all. You know, like I think about them not as like just one exercise, like that's your, you know, your lawfully wedded wife. I'm like, I want all these concubine exercises too. But if I had to choose just one, damn, this is hard.
You can have two. You can have two.
You're right. I can have two. I got a regular one and then a side chick. Let's think here. I would say I am very partial to the double kettlebell clean and jerk as the number one, because there's something about this just as a full body movement. There's like, there's everything that you could ask for. There's strength. There's explosive power. There is mobility. I'll use the term cardio in general. It's not, you know, strict cardio. Yeah, I'm a huge fan. And then a second one, I would say this is an avant-garde one maybe, but I would say a kettlebell high pull, because very few people, we talked about the upper back earlier, very few people, you know, are doing this kind of movement with any sort of external rotation of the shoulder, or, you know, moving their arms outward from their body at all, any of that sort of a thing. And very few people are really working on the upper back the way that they should. And one of the things that I found early on, just kind of stumbled upon it, was that when I did high pulls, my shoulders felt way better, because I had a shoulder issue from a stupid injury from a number of years ago. And just doing high pulls like a madman, one morning I woke up and I was like, you know what? My shoulder hasn't been hurting when I wake up anymore. This is pretty cool. So that's what I would say. Double kettlebell clean and jerk and double kettlebell high pull would be my go-to. Now I've got to ask you the same, because I'm very curious. I know you mentioned the bottoms up, and I don't know if that's going to make your list, but let's hear your two faves.
Two faves, yeah. Bottoms up, kettlebell press is going to be one, and then the get up. So actually doing the Turkish get up. And what I love to do in that one, for especially for shoulders, is in each change position to do a press.
Yeah.
In each position, and sometimes I would even combine the bottoms up press in that with the get up as well. I really love that, because you hit loads of different shoulder angles and get loads of different stretches as you're actually going through the position, especially when the one hand's posted. You get that lovely pec stretch before you do the press as well. So yeah, the bottoms up press and the get up would be my two. So more from a mobility, rotator cuff grip strengthening aspect, I would jump into with those. But yeah, like when it comes to workouts, I get bored really, really quickly. So like just sitting on a rowing machine or a bike or anything, I find quite boring. But see, just kettlebell movements and just going through them, doing swings until you can't, then doing cleans till you can't, then doing overhead jerks till you can't, and then go back to the swings again and just keep moving. Like, you're getting a sweat on, you're breathing heavy, and you're building muscle at the same time. Like, it's pretty handy. It's pretty good exercises to do, you know? So, yeah, very underrated movement, I think, or tool.
I think, you know, first of all, I have to agree, bottoms up stuff. If I could go back, if somebody said, actually, I have to go back and change the answer, I would definitely include bottoms up anything. I think bottoms up clean and press, bottoms up squat. If you're really, you know, in for an adventure, bottoms up snatch periodically. Those are also fun. It's very precarious. You don't want to do them where there's a tile floor. That much is
no.
Sure. Unless, of course, you're a tile floor, you know, salesman, in which case you can be like, no, you should definitely do bottoms up snatches on your tile floor. Here's my card. But yeah, bottoms up stuff is incredible. And I'll put it this way. If I could choose a third, I would definitely include anything bottoms up in there. It would be hard for me to get rid of the clean and jerk and the high pull. But yeah, I think the other great thing that you mentioned too about the Turkish getup is just the fact that you can get to so many different angles if you're a little bit creative about how you do it. So if you're not doing it just the standard way, but you're including the presses, it's just incredible the kind of training you can get for your shoulders, and how often people are like, wow, my shoulders feel like, you know, swollen like crazy, but they feel good. They don't feel like, you know, I'm not like completely infirm now, you know, and in need of, you know, like an assistant to, you know, grab stuff off the shelf for me. So, it's like I said, it's hard to pick just two. Mm-hmm.
I think, like, for an advanced lifter, I think the Turkish get up, if you start to go, right, how heavy can I go with this? And so as long as you're an advanced lifter and you've got good shoulder stability already there, you only have a certain amount you've got to get from like the likes of planks and bodyweight core exercises. Let's add some weight to that, because like all those positions, like I said, if you're lifting heavy enough, you're going to have to pause at them anyway, but you just get so many different benefits from different angles. And that's a core exercise. I love progressively loaded core exercises. And that's to me what the kettlebell can really provide. If you have a nice selection of them, you can have so much strength to get from using them in the right ways. So yeah, phenomenal tool.
Absolutely. I couldn't agree more. And again, like I said, it always surprises me that there are still people hating on them in, 2023, but it's not that uncommon. You go online and there's always somebody who's bad mouthing them, but I can't think of a better tool to do like what you talked about. Bunch of swings, bunch of cleans, bunch of jerks. I mean, leaving the swings aside, which you couldn't do it with a barbell, you wouldn't be able to safely do like a really tough workout like that with a barbell clean, barbell jerk, snatch, doesn't matter. It's just the sort of a thing that doesn't lend itself well to most people. And then even for the people to whom it does lend itself well, there's really only so many reps you can do before you get into dangerous territory. And most people are going to get the most benefit out of being able to do something repeatedly and safely and having like a margin for error, as well as a margin for individualizing the technique, as opposed to having to try to mold your body around what the barbell wants you to do. You know, it's no disrespect to the barbell, but yeah, the kettlebell does have some huge advantages that a lot of people do not want to admit. We want to admit it, but not everybody's so generous, I think.
Awesome. Well, yeah. Anyway, for us, for finding us, tommorrison.uk is our main website. But if you just Google Tom Morrison, I'll pop up. There's probably topless photos. You're welcome. So you can go to the site. We've loads of blogs, loads of free info, our YouTube channel as well. If you just search Tom Morrison, again, we have loads of free info. We are on TikTok, Tom Morrison, Instagram, Tom Morrison Training, and Facebook. We're on just Tom Morrison as well. So you can follow us on whichever platform suits you. We upload different types of content to each one. For getting started with us program-wise, the Simplistic Mobility Method, that's your main meat and potatoes, really, of everything that we do. It's how I assess people. It's what I take people through. It's how I fixed myself, and it's how I've helped to, you know, help thousands and thousands of people all over the world now. And we've nearly touched 20,000 people with SMM now. And if you just read through the reviews, you'll see like so many people of all different backgrounds and different types of training and all being helped with this same program. So there is method to what we do. So there's, like I always say, there's method in the madness. So we like to, you know, make you take yourself less seriously and stuff, and, you know, have a bit of fun with things. But yeah, when we actually get stuck into doing the training, it's like, this is the stuff that works, and this is the stuff that works now. in the fastest way, which is what everybody wants. So yeah, SMM, it's called the Simplistic Mobility Method, and it helps you to get flong and sexible. And then, yeah, I think that was the only two questions, wasn't it? Where to find us and where to start with us?
That was it. Yeah.
Yeah. Awesome.
So folks, tommorrison.uk and the simplistic mobility method, or SMM. I have to be careful with how I say that, because it could come out as S and M, which I assume was probably at least part of the appeal of giving it that name. It's got that kind of like the play on words almost built into it. It's just adjacent to it. So
yeah, it was really the members that actually started pointing that one out. Well, it was the members that started calling it SMM first. And then, yeah, oh, I nearly said S and M. And then, yeah, it became a big thing in our marketing. So if you've seen our adverts, you'll see a guy pop up who I tell to go away whenever I say, no, it's SMM, not S and M. So
that would also explain Thong Thursday, I suppose, now that I think about it.
Absolutely.
Yes. Okay. It's all coming together. Okay, folks, long story short, tommorrison.uk. Check him out on YouTube, Instagram, Facebook, all of the other platforms that you are interested in, and you will find him and pick yourself up the Simplistic Mobility Method, no ball gag required. I almost was able to spit that out without laughing. So, Tom, thank you very much for being on the show.
Thank you for having me.
And folks, as always, have fun and happy training.